I saw box trolls today.
For all his life, Eggs and his adopted family have struck fear into the hearts of their neighbors above.
Box trolls are monsters.
And because they were a bit, well, different, they spend their days happily underground.
Box Trolls is pretty good. And not only is the animation flawless and fluid, and it gets better every time they do a film, see Coraline, see Paranorman before that, but the design of the puppets and how expressive they can be gets better every time they do this kind of stuff. It's really a remarkable work. It's a shame that the majority of this video will be focused on talking of one topic and one topic alone, but it's one of the really most elephant in the room scenarios you could possibly master. But before that, we need to talk about the villain of this film, which is absolutely perfect as a villain, that is. It's a perfect antithesis to the main characters. The titular box trolls are basically monsters that society has deemed as monsters. While the villain, Snatcher, that's his name, is actually a monster that society created. This obtuse, hypocritical and elitarian society, where a man's worth is determined by the color of their top hat. White for the people in charge, red for the lowest common denominator, who are just there to serve society and being looked down upon, which is exactly the color of the villain's top hat. He's decided to start a crusade against the box trolls, the creatures living underground, which are all really fun-loving, shy people that do nothing wrong to anyone, but they're seen as monsters because they are different. Topical. He's starting this crusade because he sees the box trolls as an excuse to escalate, socially speaking. His goal is to join the white-hatted guy so he can actually taste cheese along with them. Fine cheese, because the city is a fictional Eastern European city, or a fictional country that revolves around cheese tasting. The people in charge do nothing but taste cheese and forget everything else, you know, which is clearly a satire about people in charge in general of our country. They just think of themselves, metaphorically and in this case literally, sitting around the tables, tasting their own cheese and what's the term I'm looking for? Drowning in their own self-centeredness, ignoring everything else, the problems of the little people and the such like. This is where the Willems comes in. Society told him, society keeps telling him, that his existence is inferior, that he is nothing. So he doesn't want to be nothing. He wants to become like the white-hatted guy, important, and he stops at nothing to go there. You see, the theme of the film is self-identity and self-acceptance versus the identity forced upon you by society. The villain is perfect as a villain because he hates himself and he aspires to be what he is not. He aspires to be the guy who's eating cheese with the cool guys, which is ironic because he's actually allergic to cheese and eating cheese might kill him. I don't need to tell you how overly ironic the ending of the film will be in that case. You see, As I was saying, he doesn't stop at nothing to get there. He is consumed, he's also consumed by self-loathing, because he is not what society deems as valuable. He wants to become what he is not, because he cannot accept himself, his own self, as an existence worth living. Which is again the perfect opposite to the main character, which are the box trolls and by extension even the boy that they adopt. They know who they are, they know who they want to be, and they like themselves for what they are, in spite of what society tells them. I will get to them later. The villain wants to be what he is not, that's important. At the same time, the villain actually also does a bit of cross-dressing. Now, we need to make an important statement here. The authors of this film are not telling you that cross-dressing is wrong. They are not even telling you that being gay or transsexual is wrong, which is not the case here. Cross-dressing is neither of those things, not necessarily at least. But they are telling you that that cross-dressing, in the context of what the villain Snatcher is using it for, is a form of escapism from your true self. It's a form of denial. And that's where we start to have a problem. When I specifically start to have a problem with the film. You see, I believe, I could be wrong here, but I believe that those who do cross-dressing, and I don't mean just people who, I don't know, wear a costume at a convention, do cosplay and all that, no. I mean, those who cross-dress professionally, as a job, as a career, they do that because they love doing it. They do that not because they want to escape from their uncool real selves. They're doing it because they are expressing themselves. Cross-dressing, I believe, is one of the purest and most open, in-your-face forms of self-expression. By having the villain of this film cross-dressing because his other persona, Madame Frufru, I believe the name is actually accepted by the same society that would normally frown upon that sort of behavior. The film is implying, with that, that cross-dressing is again a form of escapism. At least it's being used by the villain as a form of escapism, because he doesn't really care much about cross-dressing itself, which is clearly delivered to us, well, if you can read between the lines of his various discourses, which are tight, really nicely done writing in overall. If you read between the lines, he basically tells you that his Madame Frufru semi-burlesque act, of which clearly others don't know that is an act, they don't know Frufru is and Snatcher are the same person, but anyway, it's there for the sake of others. It's there for the enjoyment of others, not for the enjoyment of Snatcher himself. He does not enjoy it. He does it because it's something that gets him accepted. Not for who he is, but for the for his fake persona. They love Madame Frufru. They don't like Snatcher, though. But while all that is going on, he still wants to belong with the cool guys, with the guys with the white hat. He wants to belong up there by doing his box trolls exterminating agenda. So Madame Frou Frou is just there to satiate his need to be liked. It's not there because he simply enjoys cross-dressing. And do you see the problem here? It's a bit more complicated than it looks at first glance. They are implying again that cross-dressing is escapism, or at least that the villain is using it for the wrong purposes. Because again, he hates himself. He does not accept himself, and he's in the wrong because of that, and because he's almost, well, is he was about to be a child murderer too, but... So yes, that is the problem, really. It's not really that big of a problem, and it can be actually reinterpreted in other ways too. Maybe his burlesque act was there to be some sort of a... to mock this society, the kind of society that would normally frown upon the activity of pretending to be what you are not, which would be really clever if the guy who cross-dresses wasn't the villain but was instead Victor Victoria. But it's not, so there is this little unfortunate implication that it's actually not that bad as to say, "Oh, the guy who still like our homophobes." That is just stupid and ignorant on your part to even say, to even imply something like that. I mean, they had a gay character in Paranorman, which we didn't know was gay up until the very end, so we did not judge him for his gayness, but for his actual characteristics as a human being. And if you think about it, the ending, by the end of this film, the main character, the little kid that was adopted by the box trolls, ends up with two fathers! His biological father and the one who adopted him. Oh yes, that totally sounds like a homophobic thing to do. So yes, there is this controversy about cross-dressing that actually doesn't really is a... not necessarily a controversy, because I believe the film does an excellent job in balancing that out from a thematic standpoint. You see, so we have the villain who hates himself and he cross-dresses to escape from himself. On the other hand, we have the box trolls who began wearing those signature boxes of them in an attempt to hide in fear from society. But by the end of the film, they start wearing the boxes, after shedding them momentarily, they start wearing them again, simply because they enjoy wearing boxes. It's part of who they are, so they are proud of who they are. And there is also the little guy who starts wearing underwear, but that's good too, because it is his own choice. It's society, at the end of it, that has to change and adapt to the individual and his rights to be what they want to be, and not the other way around. So just because society tells you you aren't supposed to do this or that, that doesn't mean you are wrong for doing them. Of course, within reasonable limits. But yes, that is a... Be who you are. That is a simple, straightforward, and good and ever-present and good message to deliver in a family-friendly film that can be enjoyed by kids and adults alike. And Box Trolls is just that. An excellent film with a good message that might fumble upon itself for the silliest of reasons, really. If you think too much about it, like I did. But then again, it is the kind of thing that wants you to think. So that's what I'm doing, I'm thinking about it. And just thinking about it, I come up with some interesting topics about cross-dressing, of all things. Which is, again, a form of self-expression, not a form of escapism, I believe. I'm not an expert, I don't claim to be. So, with all that said, Box Trolls is just fantastic. I am amazed and delighted that this kind of stop motion in the feature still gets done and still gets released in the cinema. And I am just glad that Studio Laika keeps making them. You know, let's talk a little bit about other characters in this film, because they are fantastic characters. The box trolls are the ones that steal the show, really. They are all perfectly well-rounded individual with perfectly well-rounded personality, and they are not just some sort of caricature to get a few laughs from, like the minions in Despicable Me. Ugh. The scene at the beginning, which they spend time with the adopted boy, which is basically entirely without dialogues. It's all show don't tell. It's so beautiful. I cannot even begin to tell you how beautiful it is, because you have to watch it. Why are you not watching Box Trolls? Go watch it, dang it! The acting is excellent, as far as I can tell. Well, through, you know, Italian localization, but... which is too bad, because I'm missing Ben Kingsley as the Snatcher. Also that song by... composed by Eric Idle. But, yeah. The message is good, the execution is almost flawless, almost, and the characters are memorable and likable in their own right. Even the minions of Snatcher are interesting to watch. There is this pair of doofuses that are actually constantly debating their moral alignment, so to speak, with Snatcher. They force themselves to believe they are the good guys, because otherwise they couldn't bring themselves to do those horrible deeds that involve kidnapping innocent box trolls and using them for some nefarious reasons. But they are constantly questioning their moral alignment, which makes for compelling characters. And then there is this red-headed little girl, which is the daughter of the main white-hatted guy, that kind of looks a bit like Van Gogh, you know, the painter, the one who cut his own ear. And she has this lovable, morbid side to her, and she's kind of disappointed that the box trolls don't turn out to be child-eating monsters, as they were depicted in the stories. It's okay to be who you want to be, even if you're a bit morbid in doing so, as long as you don't become a snatcher. So yes, go watch Box Trolls, everybody. Tell me what you think about it. As for me, I have a shirt to put on, so if you'll excuse me, I'm just a sweet box troll from Box Trollia, Transylvania.